You may be seated. Thank you for coming to our meeting today. The first item on the agenda is citizen concerns. If there are any citizens who would like to address the board on any item that does not appear on the agenda, please come forward, state your name and address, and we will hear any concerns that you may have. Hearing none, we will move on to approval of the agenda dated May 24, 2016.
Move it.
Motion, is there a second? Motion and second discussion. Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no, and the motion carries 5-0. Item number 5 is the approval of the minutes of the May 17, 2016 meeting.
Move it.
Second.
Motion and a second, is there discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed say no, and the motion carries 5-0. Item 6 is the discussion and approval of claims.
We have change.
There was a code section change. Jean Jessen, auditor's office. There was a code section change as it relates to mental health fee claims. Instead of them going to Sioux Rivers, the Iowa code changed that they come back to the county auditor's office for payment. To date, we have about $42,000 that we would like you to approve us paying tonight. It's taken a while to get back from Sioux Rivers region back to us with the notification that it was a county expenditure. So I don't know, Dennis, if you want to.
We did have a joint Sioux Rivers meeting today. This was discussed at the Sioux Rivers meeting. There's a pending by, I think, a judge made the pending that.
I didn't get a real clear answer.
Yeah, I think they said potentially it was a judge that made a determination. The code read that the county should be responsible for it. Problem is, it was not budgeted for this current fiscal year, which will come out of general supplemental funds. We have to pay it, whether we have it budgeted or not. The second year, which is next fiscal year, unless the code changes or a different interpretation, that will probably be stuck for another $50,000-$60,000 or more. So yeah, it's still kind of in the air a little bit. I think Mark did request a little more clarification on it, I believe. Matthew did too, so we're kind of going from there. But right now we are stuck paying the claims.
What are the claims for?
Mental health commitments.
Substance abuse, I believe.
Oh.
Yes, okay. Which mental health doesn't cover substance abuse. It's just how an individual read the interpretation of the code. That's what they're going by now.
So, Dennis, are you asking that those claims, are they on for approval today?
They're included in there because we've had interpretation, we have to pay them.
And we have attorneys calling and asking for their money.
Right. I think that I would ask the board to delay it at least until next week so that I could review this. Because I'm not sure that I necessarily agree with the Sioux Rivers board on this issue.
Is it the board or is it a ruling of a judge?
We don't know.
Well, if there is one, I haven't seen it.
I sent you the two code sections that they provided and that we had looked at this point.
Yeah, and the code hasn't changed on the substance abuse side. It did change on the mental health side, where it specifically references paying over or submitting the claim to the Sioux Rivers region, but they didn't make the change on the substance side. But the payment source for the substance abuse attorneys has been mental health funds in the past.
Is that what this is for, is substance abuse?
I believe so.
Well, that wouldn't come out of mental health funds.
Well, I would move we approve the claims with the exception of this item.
That would
right, it's not for it's not for treatment of substance abuse. It's for paying the attorneys to represent the respondents in the substance abuse committals.
That's correct.
And that's come out of mental health funds in the past, so this is something different.
I would second that motion. Is there discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no, and the claims with that stated exception are approved 5-0. Item number 7, good news report. The first one is Supervisor Munson asked to give an update on the further education of Michelle Scaff, who I understand is with us today, Director of Emergency Management.
And please come forward. We're going to make you suffer through this.
Okay. Yes. Okay.
Michelle Scaff passed her defense of her dissertation on April 20th and achieved her PhD in political science from the University of South Dakota with an emphasis on public administration. Her dissertation research determined what factors influence implementing technology at the local law enforcement level in the state of Iowa. The findings were it is leadership in the form of social influence that matters. Also, the facilitating conditions such as proper training and equipment need to be available. And most statistically significant is self-efficacy. An individual must perceive that they are capable of using the technology to achieve the desired goals. Michelle is trying at this point to figure out what she'll do with all her free time since she's been in school since forever. And she's got a few free nights and weekends.
That's right.
Are we to refer to you as Dr. Scaff now?
You can just call me Doc.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And we probably need to thank your husband for putting up with it forever.
8 years.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Scaff. The other, and I'll mention this briefly because we have another good news item, so to speak. SCDC committed the largest loan award to date in this region and area in Woodbury County. That's the Pioneer Valley Living and Rehab Center, 78 beds, 53 high-paying jobs in this $13 million project. It's a great project that's going on, and they mentioned some of the most state-of-the-art facilities. And as you can see from some of the backup information, they have to, by SBA law, have geographic parity. But even given that, as regards hotels, the highest concentration of the counties that are listed, the 21 counties, is right here in Woodbury County. So over in Sergeant Bluff, this is a great project. And I think the folks at SCDC for their due diligence and help in the economic development world. We'll now move on to Siouxland Center for Active Generations. We have some folks with us today before our set time for the budget hearing. And so would like to welcome three different individuals who will honor, and then we'll hear a brief presentation on the Siouxland Center for Active Generations. Do we have Frank Morse with us today? Sir, if you don't mind coming up to the front, your service has caught our attention, sir, and we thank you for it. I won't read this verbatim, but just want to mention some of the things that Frank has done as of late. Demonstrated himself to be an outstanding citizen by volunteering. He's a senior helpmate volunteer driver for nearly 9 years, is that correct? And has been a help to older residents retaining their independence for doctor's appointments, grocery stores, other necessary trips. And listen to this. This individual has driven over 123,000 miles. That's 4,900 trips. And without your support, they wouldn't be able to do all the good things that they do. So would you join me in thanking Mr. If you wouldn't mind coming around, I'll give this to you.
I'd like to introduce my wife right here. She's also a driver.
Oh, great.
And, this way?
Yes, sir. If you'd like to stand and be recognized, too, we'd like to recognize you if you'd stand up. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Well, I guess it was too quick for you.
Team. The next individuals, sir.
I'd like to accept this on behalf of all of our drivers, because we have about 10 or 12 drivers. We put on a lot of miles. Our clientele are the older people in Sioux City and Siouxland area, and we always need more drivers. So if you guys are looking to volunteer, why, we could always use you. Thank you so much. Appreciate
it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Next individual is Wendy Beavers. Is Wendy with us as she makes her way forward? Wendy has been an integral part also of Siouxland Center for Active Generations for Mercy Home Care. Wendy has been instrumental in making Cruise Week as fun as it is, always working to improve the week's activities for numerous years by providing photo booths, gaming tables, games, and much more, furnishing treats and prizes at the center whenever asked. And so we would like to recognize your service and thank you very much.
Thank you.
Would you join me?
Jeremy, please turn, this way. Whoa, Wendy.
I think we're supposed to take a photo.
Turn this way and smile.
Okay, how's that? Thanks so much. Next individual is Ron McEwen. And Ron, as he makes his way forward, has taught painting classes, entertained at the center, played for fundraiser dances, created beautiful artwork for the Fall Follies and other events. He's always up for a challenge. He contacts news stations, we understand, when photo opportunities happen at the center. Wrote an essay for the United Way application, and has been giving of his time and his talents for over 14 years. And I really appreciate that very much.
Well, thanks very much. Thank you for this honor.
Absolutely.
All right. I have one addition. The little guy on the steps is a mini McEwen.
Boy, is he ever. I'm telling you right now. But his dad. Thank you, guys.
Like to do, if it's okay, it is 4:43. We're coming up to a set time in our meeting, and that means that a set time means it's set and there's no ifs, ands, or buts, or we get in trouble with the folks on either side of the tables here if we don't meet that. I had asked Linda if she would give a short presentation, but I think a minute or two is too short. So if it's okay with consensus of the board, we'll hold the public hearing and then ask you to speak briefly about what the Siouxland Center for Active Generations does. Do I have consensus to be able to do that? So we'll hold for a couple more minutes so that we can dispense with our set time, and then we'll have you come forward. So if you hold back there, we really appreciate it and appreciate being able to learn what it is that you folks do on behalf of the center, Siouxland Center for Active Generations. Well, with that, we are going to hold a public hearing, but I think it's appropriate if, Dennis, you want to go ahead and give a couple of introductory remarks concerning the budget amendment.
Okay, this is our one and only budget amendment this year for our fiscal year 2016 budget. It totals around $6.3 million. Of that, $5.5 million is CIP projects, secondary road projects, improvements of secondary roads, FEMA projects, also RISE projects. So that's the bulk of our budget amendment. The rest is pretty much housekeeping, things that we did not budget for at the time because we did not have the knowledge of the information at that point in time, just general items that do come up during the year.
Denny, I've got one question.
Okay.
For the cash reserves, general basic, how far down does that take us?
Okay, that's approximately 1% of our cash reserves, but we did rebuild for next year 0.5%, so it's actually taking down 0.5%. In reality, it may not exist if we take any reserves down. It depends how people spend their budgets at the end of the fiscal year, which generally we always have 0.5% or 1% of our total operating budget that does not get spent, that stays in the reserves.
As of this amendment, what would our percentage be?
Probably be right around 19.5. Our goal is 20%, I think, next year.
That was one of my concerns looking at this at first blush. I was concerned about the increase until I learned of the, you know, most of this is secondary road CIP. The worst case scenario, and you correct me if I'm wrong, is 463,000 into reserves on all funds and 292,000 in general basic, which is about the 1%. If we had not had the 0.5% that you alluded to, that would help to mitigate that.
Correct.
So about 0.5% would be the worst case scenario.
Worst case, yes.
And you'll have that actual figure.
Usually we'll have that probably at the end of August when we get through our accrual side, which is period 13, which is July and August. Payments we make for expenditures incurred before June 30th didn't show up till then. So toward the end of first part of September, we'll have a pretty good idea.
All right, we are now in a public hearing for the amendment for the current county budget. This is an opportunity for anyone to speak either for or against this amendment to the current FY16 county budget. Is there anybody who would like to address the board?
Hearing none, I would move that we close the session. The hearing.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to close the public hearing. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed say no, and the motion carries 5-0. Now, do we need to have a motion? Yes, we do, to approve the amendment of the current FY16 county budget.
Move it.
Motion, is there a second?
Second.
A motion and a second, discussion?
We don't have it listed as all.
Yeah, we have a...
No, I'm talking about on the agenda.
We have it listed as an action item.
For the public hearing.
Is that a concern?
No, it's a public hearing. It's a public hearing for the amendment of the current county budget.
So implicit in that is the action that we're about to take?
That's your attorney.
Yeah.
I think ideally it would be listed separately.
Based.
It always has been, hasn't it?
Yeah, I want to address this. This is exactly the way we had it last year, because I copied it right off of last year, the agenda item. I just made it 2016 to 2015.
Is a week delay any problem?
The people need to know where their budgets are, because we're getting toward the end of the year, so they need to plan accordingly. But we've always had the amendment hearing and amendment at this side, at this agenda item, expressed this way.
But statutorily, there's no problem with delaying it another week?
No.
Sure. There is a statutory issue with your late night meetings. These have to be reported by June 1st. If our next meeting is May 31st, we wouldn't be able to report it to the state till the next day, which would place us late. That would be my understanding on it. It's the same deal with the DOT budget that's also up for your consideration today during my items. So I would like to see you give the benefit of the doubt on this one, if possible. especially since we've already spent some of that money pending the, or approved spending of that money pending the approval of the amendment.
Joshua.
Sorry to stick my nose in here, but I think it was important you be aware of that.
It's not a problem, except we just don't have it listed, and that's my problem with it. So.
I'm also, general assistance is also part of this budget amendment. I have completely depleted all of the general assistance funds. I asked my board last month to use alternative funding, which was approved, but not for burials, and we have one pending. So if this is not approved, I will need to deny that because we don't have the funding to approve that burial. And I'll say that not knowing whether or not this family's qualified. We just had the inquiry today. I've been kind of hoping that that wouldn't happen, but of course it did.
Sure. My impetus would be that we would move forward, especially if this is the exact way that it was listed last year, and there were no objections last year. It's listed as an action item, and the backup material says that there will be a motion to approve the amendment.
That was my question, is does it help us that there's two motions listed in the backup material that was sent out?
Well, the backup materials aren't technically part of the agenda. I think going forward, we should make sure that the agenda lists it as an action item. I don't think you're going out too far on the limb to go ahead and approve it today. But I think that we could improve the wording.
That will be duly noted and will happen in the future. You'll hold us to it. So with that, I would move to approve the amendment for the current FY16 county budget.
Second.
There's a motion and a second. Is there further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed say no, and the motion passes 5-0. We will now hear from Linda, who will give us a brief presentation of the Siouxland Center for Active Generations. Thanks so much for being with us.
Thank you. Like Jim and Taylor said, I'm Linda Santee, director at the Siouxland Center for Active Generations. I want to start by thanking all of you for inviting us today, and particularly to Chairman Taylor and to Supervisor Monson for working through the logistics of these resolutions and helping us get them to our honorees who so richly deserved the honor this year. And allowing me to talk about the center for a moment too. I also want to thank Karen James for all her help on this. Our mission at Active Generations is to enrich the quality of life and support independence and vitality for our members. This is done by meeting the social, recreational, and educational needs of members in an environment that is fun, safe, inclusive, and courteous for all. And I think we really do accomplish that mission on a daily basis. We have over 1,350 members. We have over 65 programs and activities every week at the center. And we do this with only 3.5 FTE. So as you can imagine, to be able to get this done, we wouldn't be able to get it done without our community collaborations and our member and community volunteers. I'll give a couple examples of our community collaborations. For example, with MERD, which has allowed our members to see those wonderful Broadway shows that are at the Orpheum that they otherwise wouldn't be able to see. We are going to be a polling precinct for precinct four in the upcoming primary on June 7th. We're happy about that too. And we work with, for example, the Center for Siouxland as a VITA site, so the free tax preparation. Those were the examples I had, but I would say now that I see that Jean's in the room, that we've been delighted to be able to accept one of the senior community employment, well, Jean's gone, people who are embedded in non-for-profits throughout the community, and so we're working with the Woodbury County Community Action Agency on that program too, even though I mangled the name of the program, and I'll probably hear from Jean tomorrow. And on the members and community volunteers side, I'd like to say it's exemplified not only by the people to whom you gave the resolutions earlier, but by the fact that we're receiving a Governor's Volunteer Award for Outstanding Commitment and Service. We're going to be getting that June 23rd, at Buena Vista, and it's specifically for our role in the SHIP program. You'll recall that SHIP stands for Senior Health Insurance Information Program. And at Active Generations, we have three trained volunteers who work with people to review their individual Medicare plans, including the Part D prescription drug plans that people can reevaluate every year. And in just 2015 alone, these three volunteers saved 212 customers over $76,000. That's money that's...
Where do we sign up?
Yeah, I know, right? And that's money that has stayed in those 212 souls' individual pockets and in the community at large as opposed to going to out-of-state insurance firms. So we're pleased that we're able to have saved the community $76,000. So you can see that our honorees and their colleagues, all of our volunteers, are really the lifeblood of Active Generations. So I'll be short, but let me also say that it's an exciting time to be at Active Generations. We're developing new programs that engage our members, no matter their age, in meaningful ways. there's new energy and there's new partnerships. We think the Sue Ann Center for Active Generations has always been a fun place, but we like to think that we're becoming even more fun and even more informative, more vital for our members and for the community at large. So we think we're beautifully positioned to begin a membership drive. And I would remind everyone in the room that membership is open to anyone over 18. We currently have members, in fact, ranging in age from 23 to 103. And we're happy to report that just in this past year, we've gone from 1,218 members to over 1,350 members. So we're on the right track, right? We're trending upward. And we have a goal this year to reach 1,500 members. So I'm inviting each of you in the room, supervisors, other officials, staff, public, to please consider supporting us with a membership. And you'll have the opportunity to learn all about our exciting programs and the always there general activities, the exercise room, gift shop, library, computer lab, billiard room, coffee shop, etc. And you can learn about what's happening through our monthly newsletters. I'm going to leave newsletters for everyone, and I've got some more in the back. And this is, for example, our calendar for the month, and it's kind of small print and far away, but you can see there's a lot of activities in any given month. And the other thing that's in the newsletter that's fun is we have our menu for the month open to the public, so you can, with your membership, you get the opportunity to look and decide which days you want to come in and invite your friends, because our lunch is open to the public at $5.25, so it's at a good cost too, right? So with this newsletter and the membership that it represents, you'll also know what our wonderful volunteers that you've acknowledged today already know, which is the Siouxland Center for Active Generations is a great place to stay fit, engaged, and entertained, a great place to stay young. And we again want to thank you. And I tell you what, if I haven't sold you yet on what a great place we are and how you should all become more involved with us, I'd invite anyone in the room to come for a tour any day between 8 to 4:30, Monday through Friday, and we'd love to show you around and hopefully get you to be a member at the Siouxland Center for Active Generations. So we hope to see you there.
Linda, I do have a question.
Yes, please.
Do you have any major fundraisers coming up, and how are you doing with your funding of your center? I know we used to contribute, we don't anymore, but I'm just wondering Sure. Where you stand.
Well, thank you. We don't have a real signature event. I've been looking, as you know, I've been at the center full-time since September 2015. So I've been kind of looking at the calendar this first year to see what other community events are happening and how we might fit in, both in terms of a calendar and in terms of a niche that maybe isn't happening, so it isn't another of the same event that everyone goes to, you know, all the time. So we don't have that, but in the meantime, we do have fundraisers. The next one will be a golf tournament, August 8th. And we're looking for foursomes for that. So this room could probably come up with, you know, two foursomes at least, right? and then we've had dances, we've had other activities. Right now we're relying primarily on the investment that the United Way has in us and in our membership dues and in grants, and we're trying to become more thoughtful, intentful on the grants to which we're applying and to develop relationships with the philanthropic community so that they're informing us as well as we're informing, you know, them, and we're moving forward that way in an effort to get a more robust, holistic look at how we can fund ourselves in the future.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks for the question.
I have to say I went over and to the volunteer meeting, 200-300 people, and pre-presented these plaques to the three people, then yanked them back and said they had to come here tonight. And Mayor Scott also presented them with a plaque. we picked the right people because the audience absolutely verified it.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, thank you very much for
thank
your
you.
Presentation, and thanks for all that you do. We collectively very much appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll pass it on down. So.
Linda, I already have one that comes to my house.
I receive it monthly as well.
Item number 10 is Board Administration Karen James's approval of a resolution for suspension of taxes for an individual with the initial CR.
Move it.
Second.
A motion and a second. Is there a discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed say no, and the motion passes 5-0. Item number 11 is Emergency Services, Terry Brown. This is STARCOM, authorization to reprioritize the STARCOM CIP project funding. Gary, how are you?
Good afternoon. Gary Brown with Woodbury County Emergency Services. What we're asking for the board to do is authorize us to reprioritize some capital improvement funding that was budgeted over the last, this fiscal year and next fiscal year. And let me give you just a little bit of a brief explanation. We brought the STARCOM radio system online back in 2005. It was fully implemented in 2006. It's not a conventional, what you normally see in a radio system. It's a like a supercomputer. It's just a very involved electronic radio system. It's an 800 megahertz trunked radio system is what we call it. And in order to keep that radio system alive, like any computer, you have to continuously work on refreshing the technology and the hardware that goes with it. In 2006, when we first brought the system fully implemented, it was what we called an LE system. And it was a limited edition. Motorola only sold about 10 of those systems nationwide. They came to us in 2006 and said, we would like to eliminate the LE system and we would like to upgrade you to the 7.6 platform, their current platform. And then we would like you to consider in the future upgrades besides that. So we got a free upgrade with the system when we went to 7.6. We've upgraded the microwave system that backhauls all the technology, connects all the towers together, and we're now at the point where we need to upgrade the radio system again. We've been able to consider a partnership with the state of Iowa. The state of Iowa is now building out a statewide radio system. Basically, it's very similar to what we have. It won't have quite the landline or the handheld coverage that our system enjoys, but they're building out a statewide radio system, and they want to connect to us. They want to make STARCOM a part of that radio system, and in doing that, Motorola will upgrade our radio system to the 2016 version of hardware and software. Our system is really busy. The system had almost 1 million push-to-talk or requests for service on it between January 1st and April 10th of this year. And in that, we had a 3% denial of service. In other words, 3% of the time, somebody trying to get onto the radio system couldn't. The national standard for these systems is less 1% or less. So our system is really busy. When we brought the system online, we had about 600 plus users on the system. Today, we have over 1,000 radios on the system. So Motorola and the state of Iowa have agreed to upgrade. If we join in this partnership, they've agreed to do what we originally budgeted the money to do, which was to upgrade the radio system from 7.6 to 7.16. What we're asking the board and the other governing agencies that fund STARCOM to allow us to do is to take that money that we had budgeted, which on the county side of it's $160,992, and what we've over a two-year period of time, and what we want to do with that is we want to do something called TDMA on the radio system. Right now, every time somebody pushes to talk on our radio system, we're using a channel, a frequency. With TDMA, we can actually reuse that frequency a second time, which basically, to reprioritize this money and allow us to do TDMA on the radio system with it, will double the capacity of the STARCOM radio system, and we're confident that will bring our numbers back under that 1% mark that we need to be under, you know, as a national average for denial of services. So it's basically using the funding for technology for the upgrade of the STARCOM radio system just in a little different way, and that's to increase the capacity of the system.
Questions and discussion from the board? My question is this. Can you just help us break down simply? You have $700,000 was the original CIP.
Right.
We're talking about $598,000 right. for a cost savings of $102,000.
Right.
What is the county portion of that versus, because I know it says here we're talking $169.99 for 2 years back to back.
Right. I didn't break that savings down on what the savings would be to
so
the county. The county's
the bottom
20,
line, it's essentially $102,000 right. and then whatever the county portion right. is that.
County's 23% of the budget.
Okay.
So
about $23,000,
$24,000,
$25,000
savings.
Yeah. Okay.
The other really good thing about this is by joining this partnership with the state, we will no longer have to own and maintain something called the core, which is a rack of servers. The state, we will be using the state's core. That'll result in a net savings of about $80,000 a year for us in our maintenance agreement with Motorola. And we're going to approach the StarCom board about that savings being reapplied back into what we would call an SUA or software upgrade agreement with Motorola. So in the future, instead of having to come in and ask for $750,000 or $700,000 to do a software upgrade, that $80,000 will do that over time. Every 2 years then we'll get a software upgrade by using that savings to go back into the radio system. So it'll level our budget off significantly. We're confident the work that we've done already on the microwave system has taken us into the future, and this upgrade and these will take us another step. Right now, the life cycle in this radio system is good out past 2026.
So where does the state funding come from?
The state of Iowa is using a couple different funding sources, but one of them is the Wireless 911 Surcharge Fund.
Which is basically our surcharge fund.
Yes, they're taking
so
about...
They're tapping into our funding
to
pay for a state project across the state.
Across the state.
Yeah. So they raise taxes without having to do it.
You are correct. And we were opposed to that, but the offset for that is they raised the amount. They had a significant surplus in their wireless fund, and by us opposing them using it for the statewide radio system, we were able to strike a deal that is going to increase about 13% the amount of the wireless surcharge coming back to Woodbury County.
So aren't all the users upgrading their radios?
We do need to, over the next couple of years, go into all of our handheld and mobile devices and budget to update those as well.
And all that will work on this?
Yes, because the current radios that we have on the system right now are something called FDMA. So they're going to use that full channel every time they push to talk. We can convert them over to TDMA, and we plan to reuse some of those radios coming out of service with the Volunteer Fire and EMS Corps. But the new radios that would be purchased for, like, the Sheriff's Department and the City Police and Fire, my agency, they would all have the TDMA specs inside of them. So
10 years ago, we bought them radios.
10 years ago, the wireless or the 911 Services Board bought the radios. We borrowed $2.5 million against the wired 911 surcharge, and we just retired that loan this year.
Now they got to buy them.
Correct.
So StarCom wants to go from the FDMA to the TDMA with the ISI CSB for an SUA in the CIP. Is that right?
It's only taken us a year and a half to get you to speak our language.
So.
A year and a half to get you to talk like we do.
You know, it'd be scary if you thought you knew what you were talking
right,
about.
Right. Well, with that, is there a motion to help get this thing done?
Would 10-4 work?
Yeah. What would the motion be to reduce it to 598?
Well, to allow us to take the allocated dollars that were set up for CIP for StarCom to upgrade the radio system and allow us to use them for TDMA. And we have not signed the $598,000 contract yet, so we've got to get this to everybody before I would be comfortable saying there's $102,000 savings that you could put into a motion until we...
So we move to approve the $598,000, but we've already approved the $700,000.
Basically, what I'm asking you to do is approve us to reprioritize the $700,000 and let us bring the final savings back to you.
I move that.
Second.
You
we got
have a
that,
motion and second. Is there further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed say no, and the motion carries 5-0. Thank you, Gary.
Thank you.
10-4.
Item, 12 is Human Resources. Ed Gilliland, item A is approval of the memorandum of personnel transactions.
Move it.
Second.
A motion and a second. Is there a discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed say no. Motion carries 5-0. Item B is authorized chairman to sign authorization to initiate the hiring process.
Move it.
Second.
A motion and a second. Is there a discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed say no, and the motion carries 5-0. Item C is the approval of the request to deauthorize county positions.
So moved.
Second.
A motion and a second. Is there a discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed say no, and the motion carries 5-0. Item D is a nationwide deferred compensation discussion and action. Ed.
And this was, did you all receive this in your packet? This little spreadsheet? Got a copy for everybody if you don't have it.
I thought it did make it to everybody.
I believe we have it.
I think that's, I can't see what you have, but it looks kind of like what I have over here.
It looks kind of like it, okay. Well, this, like I.
Is that this side?
Yes.
Okay, we all have this on the back of the cover sheet.
Well, very good.
And what it basically shows is just that with the current plan, what the administrative fees are approximately as percentages of the amount of dollars in your fund, that they're mostly institutional funds currently, not entirely, that with the new program, if you look on the right, it says the Nationwide Freedom Pro Plus Zero. These are all institutional funds, and there is no, I'm sorry, the zero relates to the amount of administrative fees. Those administrative fees amount to approximately $7,120 a year. There is $335 approximately that would be an expense, I guess you would list it as in foregone interest based on the current interest rates. Now, if interest rates start to go back up, that could go down to zero. And the net savings for the employees with this plan is $6,785 a year. The negatives with the current plan, you do have, you guys are the fiduciaries as far as plan selection, and you are responsible for the amount of fees there. You're held to a fiduciary standard there. With the new program, that fiduciary responsibility is shared with Morningstar in the selection of the funds, and you also are in a position where your fees are much lower, and it certainly appears to be more astute.
Is there a discussion or other questions on this item?
Is this, and I go back to last week or the week before.
Sure.
Is Nationwide the only one that's allowed to do this?
There are always more vendors that can do these things. Nationwide has the partnership with NACO and with ISAC. And part of the reason that you get the financing that you do, or you get the zero fees and those kind of things, is because you do have the sponsorship by a large organization like a NACO and an ISAC.
Pat, is your?
I think your question goes to in the county. By the board action that you took previously, NACO is the only one that the employees in Woodbury County are allowed to work with.
And does this cause your office problems? I know that we've had them in the past, and was that worked out?
What happened is that each individual vendor would have to come before the board to make a presentation whether you wanted to allow additional vendors to do it, and they would have to offer the same type of services that those folks that NACO is, because we used to allow any vendor, but it was because they were not providing the same services that NACO does that were putting duties on the county to perform that we were not had the ability to do.
Yes. We would have to go to outside counsel in order to meet those needs. So that's why NACO was selected back then as the only one that was allowed to do it.
I didn't remember everything. That,
right.
Any other questions or discussion?
Move it.
Motion, and that would be to approve the new nationwide
yes.
deferred comp plan and to allow employee meetings with a nationwide representative?
Yes.
Second.
I have a question. Yeah, I have a question on that.
Yeah, yes, sir.
What type of meetings are we talking about?
We'd like to set up the availability of nationwide to meet one-on-one with people. And possibly, and certainly at open enrollment, we'd like to, again, make a push where we provide information to people about the program and make that available so that everyone's well aware of it. They say that on a statewide basis that about 30 to 40% of county employees participate, and we're in a position where we have less than 10% that participate. And that's, you know, it's a significant hit that people are taking to their potential retirement funding.
Well, my question is, once a month, once a year?
No, there's no reason to do it once a month. I would say that probably a couple of times a year would be plenty.
In a group setting or individual?
I would say that to have him available in an individual setting. And I would say that we may want to do a kickoff. That would be up to you guys. We may want to do a kickoff where we do have group sessions where we kind of explain the overall workings of the program, the advantages, you know, whatever the negatives might be with it, and do that. But that would be entirely your call. I think that would be in everybody's best interest at some point.
We have a motion by Supervisor Monson, a second by Supervisor Smith. Any other discussion, questions? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no, and the motion carries 5-0. Item 12E is Secondary Roads Foreman Vacation Extension. This came about from discussion with the county engineer and asking, given the exorbitant amount of snow and plowing and secondary roads work, if there was anybody that should be recognized within the department. We discussed a couple of different items. One is the consistently early starts and under the previous advice of our previous HR director that those individuals needed to stay to the end of the day. We also discussed at that time if there was any opportunity for compensation time that the board may allow. And I am putting on here that I think that it's reasonable to look at a one-time extension of vacation for a week's time. My understanding is that had been done in the past. Supervisor Ung and I met with the county engineer as well as Ed on this issue, and I consulted with both Joshua and outside counsel. I understand that there is some worry as far as precedents and so on that may be set, but I believe that given some of Ed's current understanding as far as if work duties are done, in a timely manner that at the discretion of the county engineer, he may be allowed to release his people if they've concluded their days. So I don't think that this will be necessarily a recurring issue with heavy winters, but it's something that I think that the board should strongly consider.
Is this person's not a union person?
No, it's four people that are not union.
Right.
They're salaried.
Questions, discussion?
Is this person on District 3, CF?
It's all four.
While Mark's making his way up, I don't have a problem with the motion, but I think it should be left with the discretion of the county engineer, because what I think we're doing is we're granting an extra week's vacation the four foremen in perpetuity.
This is just for this 1 year. This year they had in excess of 160 hours of extra work, including Saturdays, Sundays, Forrest Johnston is starting at before 3 in the morning now, since he has those commercial industrial roads that are going down there in the CF Mid-American area, where we're starting a plow there at 4:30 as compared to 6 the normal time. This was an exceptional winter as far as the number of storm events that hit, especially with the number of weekend hours that were worked. And I think this is one where this really, I felt, went beyond just a recognition of excellent performance by these four employees, but they do dedicate a lot of time above and beyond their regular hours. And in fact, you know, they fill in running a plow at times during the winter to assist in getting the roads cleared quickly. And
I would move a one-time extension for the four roads foremen.
I'll second it.
Could I just add one more item for discussion? What we worked through with Ed as compared to the prior HR director is really refining the way that salaried employees are allowed to manage their time. We should be able to deal with much of this in the future with allowing these guys to be released on occasion rather than having to account for each hour. And you know, we're actually going to treat them like salaried employees, not a hybrid hourly salary person. So
I have a question. Gene, do you understand the time range here that they're talking about doing this?
I do not. Are you just giving them an extra 40 hours? Is that true?
That's correct.
And what does that do to their anniversary times and those types of
things? Right.
It would have no effect on their anniversary times would be the same as they are now. It would just be.
But they have to use it. That's what we're talking about.
Oh, they have to use it.
They'd have to use it. If they hit an anniversary, if you give them an extra 40 hours and they are actually kind of at the top of their level and they hit their anniversary date, we're going to take it away just like we would any other employee. So that all has to be in the mix of this.
That's
double
what
check and make sure they get the time off used. So.
Okay. Well,
I don't think
we don't know individually if they're up against that right
yeah,
now.
I would have to check, yeah.
But
I'm not
it
sure
could impact your plan.
Okay.
So.
But isn't the rule that you can't carry over more than you earned in the last calendar year? So this additional week is another week that they'd be able to carry over. At least would be my interpretation.
Programmatically at this point, no. But that's my question. I think that's the detail piece that everybody needs to agree on. Programmatically right now, if somebody can carry over 5 weeks, when they get to their anniversary, it's going to be 5 weeks.
Even if they've got 6 weeks.
If they have 6 weeks there. So all of that is processing-wise for our office is or maybe an impact. So.
We just want an understanding of
exactly what you're
when you can use it.
The hope was that they would have, you know, the balance of the year to get this used, but it would have to be calendar year.
That again depends on their date of hire and those type of things. So we'll just have to.
We can work it out. I guess the question is, it's calendar year, not
they need more than just till July 1 to be able
right.
to get this used.
Right.
So.
That's what my concern. Okay.
I think December 31st is an achievable date.
Okay. And again, depending on when their anniversary is, so we'll have to research that.
We'll double check that with Gene.
Yeah.
If we made it effective at different dates for the four of them at their next anniversary, would that simplify any of your work?
Depends on when their anniversary.
Yeah, I think the only worry is if it's 3 weeks from today, that's tough, right?
Right.
So we'll need to look at the detail of each person and determine.
As long as everybody understands it's one-time deal and it's for the calendar year, I think we can work it out.
Okay. Right. Okay.
That is a motion and a second. Any further discussion?
I guess I just have one question. So if the anniversary date is coming up in 2 weeks, they're not going to lose this benefit,
are they?
What we
would wait to credit the 40 hours until after the anniversary.
Okay.
These guys deserve it. They hustled.
I know you folks are aware of it, and this is one way to really make a substantial recognition of that.
And I understand it'll cause issues, but if it's a reward for time, I would hate those issues to get in the way of what we're trying to do here. That's rewarding.
And that's, we don't want that to happen either.
Good, so you'll work it out.
We just want to make sure everybody's aware of what could happen, and we'll work through that.
Just wanted to make sure, I mean, as long as you clarified it, it's calendar year, then we'll be good.
If you have trouble with the computer, Gene, call me.
I will do that. I'm sure you'll be able to help me out. Yeah.
Well, with that motion and a second, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no, and the motion carries 5-0.
Thank you.
I did overhear them talking about all going fishing for an extended period of time together. No, just kidding.
Item 13, Secondary Roads of Marknara. This item A is to consider approval of a contract for bridge project BRS CO971286-0-97.
This is for our bridge with Godbertson Smith Construction. This is for our bridge north of Lawton.
Second.
Motion and a second. Is there discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed say no, and the motion carries 5-0. 13B is consideration of annual tax levies for drainage districts.
This takes some time, as you have a dozen of them, so.
We just take them one by one.
That's the way we do her.
All right, we will move the Hackley Lateral Drainage District.
This one is recommended at zero. Hackley Lateral has been combined with the Farmers Drainage District or absorbed within it. Hackley Lateral currently has a balance that we're looking and working with the Farmers Drainage District to transfer that balance of funding to the Farmers District.
Which would close this one?
Yes.
Move it.
Second?
Second.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. I'm not sure how all that worked, but some of us, we're all there. And so any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no, and the motion carries 5-0.
I apologize if I confuse the issue, but each of these drainage districts, we typically levy enough to cover the amount of work that they do in an average year, cleanouts, brush, repairs that might need to be done, and it also covers their drainage district dues. The Hackley Lateral is had accumulated a balance in their fund, basically, that covered those, that was not spent prior to them being transferred to the Farmers Drainage District. It's now being managed by those trustees. But in order that we can close it out and completely close the books, it'll be necessary for us to write a check for $9,600 to the Hackley Lateral that will be credited to that area by the new trustees.
Move on the Orton Slough.
Second.
We have a motion and a second on the Orton Slough Drainage District.
Does that cover all that work?
Yes.
Is there discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no, and the resolution passes 5-0.
This covers the Orton Slough up to the acquisition of the ditch, plus the balance of the work that was done in preparing the intakes. The new ditch work that is currently being let to contract, which will improve the ditch from the railroad right-of-way to the repaired intake, will be levied next year.
Okay.
Next one is the Smoky Hollow Drainage District.
Move it.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there a discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed say no, and the resolution passes 5-0. Next is the Upper Creek Wolf Drainage District.
Move it.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed say no, and the resolution passes 5-0. Next is the Weber Creek Drainage District.
Move it.
Second.
Motion and a second. Is there discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no, and that resolution carries 5-0 as well. Wolf Creek Drainage District.
Is this for
this covers
the work we just talked about?
This covers the current work that was done, the work on the Hare property.
the work on the Tresham property, their drainage district dues, and the survey work that has been done to date in determining the needs for future maintenance on that project. The actual project that the board will be having the informational meeting on June 14th, none of that is included here.
Move it.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there a discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no, and the resolution passes 5-0. Next is the Bennett McDonald Drainage District.
Move it.
Second.
Motion and a second. Is there a discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no. Resolution passes 5-0. Smithland Drainage District.
Move it.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there a discussion?
Pretty much dues.
It's pretty much dues plus the tree cutting work that we typically do. We gravel the top of both of those levees because they are used for vehicular access for farms. So this just takes care of the average maintenance plus dues. I think dues on both of these are around $250, $260 a year.
So we have a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed say no. And that resolution passes 5-0. The Wolf Creek Pumping District, number 2.
I thought this was abandoned.
It has not been disbanded, however. It is still a drainage district that's under your jurisdiction. All the land covered by this district is now within the Owego Slough, and it's subject to NRCS wetland easements. The property is now owned by the state of Iowa, and there has not been action taken to dissolve this. This is one where Wolf Creek 2 and Wolf Creek 3 ought to be looked at for dissolution.
Move it.
We still need a motion on this then.
It has been that annually our policy states that the board will make a motion as to the taxes that should be levied.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there a discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed say no. And the resolution passes 5-0. The Bennett McDonald Smithland Special.
This is the final installment on the riprap project that was done along the Bennett McDonald Smithland. This would be the repairs that were done to the left bank along the property owned by Dennis McCall and his neighbor to the north.
Move it.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there a discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed say no, and the resolution passes 5-0. We have the Anthon Central Drainage District.
Move it.
I'll second. Is there a discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed say no, and the resolution passes 5-0. The Maple River Drainage District.
Basically covering their dues.
Move it.
Second.
A motion and a second. Is there a discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no, and the resolution passes 5-0. That brings us to item 13C, consideration of approval amendment 1 to the FY 2016 secondary road budget for Iowa DOT.
Move it.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed say no. And the approval to the amendment passes 5-0. Thank you very much. I will signing shortly. We will now recess the Board of Supervisors meeting. We'll convene the County Drainage District Trustees meeting. And we have listed approval of the May 17, 2016 minutes.
Move it.
Second.
A motion and a second. Is there a discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no. And the minutes are approved 5-0. We'll now adjourn the County Drainage District Trustees meeting, continue the Board of Supervisors meeting, and we have emergency management with Dr. Schaff, discussion of county employee credentialing.
Hello again.
Hello.
I just wanted to talk to you a little bit about implementing some technology here. So, Basically, we have the facilitating conditions in place and that we have equipment, we have software to start a credentialing program. We're going to be using it in emergency management to credential all the fire departments once we go out to all the communities and ask for their permission to do so. And we'll be also credentialing equipment within the fire departments and EMS departments around the county. Now, in the process of this, we were talking with the sheriff's office with Major Wick about the county ID, so we thought that it would be a good idea to dual purpose and credential the county employees at the same time. So I believe there was some discussion last week at the board meeting in reference to the credentialing concept. We did have a small planning meeting in which Matthew, Ed, myself, John Malloy from IT, and Major Wick was included in the information to discuss what process may work in credentialing the employees. So I just wanted to come today to talk with you to see if you have any questions about the credentialing concept, and then next week come back to the board for approval to begin. I've tried to highlight some of the costs that are anticipated for the future for this project. Right now we've got all of the cards, including proxy cards, to be able to credential all of the employees. Part of the process is going to be to renew the IDs every 4 years, so there will be a cost every 4 years, as well as any new employees that may need an ID as they come through HR, they would create a credential for them. And they'll all be printed out at TSI in the emergency management office there. Right now we have the cards, we have lanyards that were given to us by the sheriff's office, and we look for some grant funding, but unfortunately the grant that I have funding for will not cover credentialing. The items we do not have, this is your basic credential, and the items that we do not have is this black case that helps to protect them. Since these are intended to last 4 years, it's good to have a good protective covering instead of just something plastic over them. So that's what we have right now as far as the concept. We'd like to get this going as soon as possible. We do know that there are a few employees who are in need of an ID right now, that their old one has gotten damaged or whatever it may be, so.
This is going to replace our current county IDs.
Yes, and employees who need a proxy card for access, we can use those as proxy cards also, so they'll be able to gain access to the Security Institute, the courthouse, the law enforcement center. Between myself and the sheriff's office, we can give access to all of those. There are some employees who have access to City Hall and to the police department, the schools, and some other areas, so we will have to bring some other players into it to get those cards access to those buildings also.
This will not replace our fobs?
Yes, it will.
Will replace the fobs?
Yes. It'll be a good way for us to maintain credibility with the IDs and the fobs also. If we replace them every 4 years, we're always guaranteed to have the most current and accurate information on them.
Who's going to control this? You and the sheriff?
What we're going to do for this initial credentialing is we're going to form a team of one person from the emergency management team, one person from the sheriff's office, and one person from HR, and we'll go out to the departments and we'll get all the information entered into the computers. They'll be printed out at TSI, and then for new incoming employees and for the renewals every 4 years, those will be done with the HR department for supplies. It will always be printed out. We only have one printer, and that's out
of
TSI.
Who's going to have control to say they no longer have access?
Kind of a combination, if you will.
It's essentially a combination. Major Wick has ultimate control. So what would happen is we would have the responsibility in HR to notify Major Wick upon any employee's termination. And what I'm wondering too, something that came up in today's county day, what about the potential for IDs for others who work in Trosper Hoyt or who work in the courthouse who aren't county employees? That was one of the questions we had. And is there an
address for that? Committee's got work.
Yeah, we're going to be using it for other functions besides just the county credentialing. The only concern I think right here for the board is the county employees, and if other organizations are related to emergency management functions, then we'll work with those individuals. But there are going to be a few more players than the sheriff's office as far as the access to the proxy cards, depending on what that individual's role is. For example, a lot of people within the sheriff's office has access to different buildings. At TSI, I'll have to give access for the proxy cards there, and I think John Malloy will help us with City Hall for employees that have access over there and the police department. So we do have a few people that we're going to have to bring into it for that card access, and I think that's going to be the biggest obstacle to get the proxy cards programmed exactly the way that the key fobs currently are, because it's not just a click of a button and it's going to have access to all those buildings.
We don't have to change anything as far as on the doors?
No, nothing on the doors. We have the cards were ordered and they were tested and they're functional at all of the county buildings.
And this is going to take place when?
Well, next week I'll ask for approval to begin. I have spoke with Pat to use his department as the first department to work with them to credential them in the way that they would like, to give proxy cards to some, regular IDs to others, and then we'll make sure that we work out any problems that we may encounter before we start working with others. I'd like to get to the sheriff's office as soon as possible. We've had a lot of requests. Well, we've had requests from Major Wick that we try to get some of their employees credentialed.
Could you cover how it would help the county in the case of an emergency as far as keeping track of people?
Yes. We have another system that's called a rapid tag printer, and what that does is if there is a large-scale emergency, such as, say, a tornado that goes through an area, and we have an access point to that location, as individuals come into the emergency, they will use their credential and they will be scanned in, so it will keep track of hours of those individuals going in and off of the scene. And what this does is we can print reports and it'll keep track of all of the hours. We can do this for volunteers as well, volunteer hours. And then if there is a FEMA reimbursement, we have all of that information at the touch of a button available to us. So it's a pretty sharp system. We're going to use it in exercises and training, so we're used to using that system.
Just knowing who's in there is good news.
Yes.
Very good. Any other questions or discussion? Thank you very much. We'll look forward to seeing you back.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Item number 16, Board of Supervisors, Mark Monson. This is a little courthouse in Anthem, potential county ownership and compensation.
I think we all agree that we would like to take possession of the little courthouse. I think we all agree that we need to fix it. And I think the estimates, well, getting it so it won't leak is going to cost $2,000-$3,000. Okay, and that I think we can get done through building services, which will put off major repair for a year or two. With that said, Kenny estimated repair at $30,000, which in a year or two could be put on the CIP to take care of that. I think the only issue with this group is what we might give them for turning that building back over to the county, turning it over to the county. They want it stipulated in the agreement that if we would ever vacate it, they'd get it back, which I don't have any problem with that either. So the issue is really how much would we give them, and I'm leaving that open.
Is there discussion or questions on this item?
I'm totally fine with the stipulation. As far as the use, I think everyone, since the work group was started by Chairman Taylor, that everyone agrees that it's a central county function. The price, as far as the purchase price, is a somewhat new development, and I don't think it sets a very good precedent countywide if we were to actually purchase this building to fulfill the need. I think they don't charge us rent for the same reason that we don't charge them a convenience fee for being out in the county. If we were to operate under the status quo, if we were to continue to make small repairs, just put a bucket here or there, so to speak, make sure things are working at the bare minimum, then I would say the gentleman's agreement would continue, but I don't think that's a very good way to go forward legally. But since we are committing, or at least in my estimation, we would be committing to $30,000 worth of repairs, possibly more, in a unique way that the county has not embarked on before, that is an extra contribution in itself from the county. And so I don't think anyone is interested in a loggerheads, so to speak, of you know, of a bidding mechanism. I think that we just need to get this turned over to the county. We need to commit to the repairs. We need to agree to the stipulations of the use, and we need to continue the service that we provide.
I've been thinking about this back and forth, and kind of going back and forth in my mind on it. And I think the idea, if we invest, let's say, $30,000 or more in this building, and have that stipulation, we're going to improve this building to such a degree that it'll be functional and we'll be able to be out there. But if we were not out there, we'd simply be returning it back to the city council if we didn't no longer used it for its intended purpose. I think that's a way to sort of meet already the needs that are there. I think it'll be a substantial investment. And so I would tend to think that that in and of itself would be something that I think would be good going forward. I don't know if a necessary contribution. I know I kind of talked to you a little bit about this, Mark, and I've gone back and forth. I'm going to be open with you in my mind as to what to do. But that's, I think, where I'd stand right now is if we're going to invest and use it as in order to serve the community with that stipulation that it would revert back to the city if it weren't used in order to service their residents and those around them. I think that that's a fair shake at that. I don't know what everyone else thinks.
Well, I agree with that. You know, someone threw out a dollar last time. I think that's a good starting point. Didn't we purchase that Climbing Hill building for a dollar? Not very much out there.
I think it was 8,000.
No, we bought that from the school district.
From the school district. Yeah. Because it is a convenience, it drives traffic, economic development activity results because that little courthouse is out there. So I think it as a convenience to pay the repairs is okay, willing to do that, but not to buy the building on top of it. I just think 10,000 is too stiff, and I would support a dollar.
Joshua, we have to own this building in order to repair it, correct?
Not necessarily, especially given the fact that we're not paying rent. I mean, they could continue to own it, and our reimbursement for being there could essentially be the repairs. You don't have the issue. If it was owned by a private entity, you'd have the issue of enriching a private entity. But since it's another governmental entity.
Except they're insuring the building, and we're not.
Right. I think there's reasons on their end that it would make more sense for us to own it than them. But as far as actually us making repairs, we wouldn't necessarily have to own it to do that.
Do you think it'd be cleaner or easier in the sense? I mean, when I had the first call, my nervousness, because I was looking for precedence, was if we would have any, you know, if there was a contractor doing work for us and there were any sort of liabilities or things that happened. And he said, well, it was your contractor. We didn't authorize this in our building. Do you think it would be more seamless if it was under the county's and we were making what are going to be substantial repairs, even though we maybe could?
Right.
Would it be maybe a better position to be in, do you think? Or
yeah, I think so, you know, especially if there's going to be substantial repairs or investments in the building. I'll have to visit with the other attorney as far as what the agreement would look like as far as reversion back to the city. There's some legal obstacles that you run into if it's actually written into the deed that it's a reversion. But it would be more likely that it would be something along the lines of they would have an option to purchase it, like a right of first refusal sort of thing, whether that's for a dollar or some other amount. That's probably how we would do the documents on it.
I would make a motion that we, pending Joshua's conversation with their attorney, offer a dollar for the building with all repairs done by the county and the insurance provided by the county, with the reverting back to them should we vacate. I think that covers everything.
I could vote for that motion if you didn't include the insurance in there, because it might be more financially less expensive if the city just has it under a blanket out there.
Well, but we're self-insured, so.
Well, that's what I'm getting at, because if somebody slips and falls on the sidewalk,
we're going to get sued anyway, whether they insure it or do we do.
Right, but we don't own the building. Don't, I think our liability is.
No, I'm not sure.
Whether
the tenant.
The motion is as stated, or simply to buy it, or signal our intent to buy it for a dollar, doesn't it have to go before the city council for their own public hearing to see what they're amenable to?
Well, but Josh, this is to allow Joshua with those terms to negotiate with their attorney. Then it has to come back here in city council.
Right, and since we're self-funded, basically, I mean, we won't have to take out a separate insurance policy on that building, but
no, but we are.
We'll be responsible if we take ownership. But we already share an extent of the responsibility and the fact that it's county personnel that are there in the building, and I believe it's building services that are maintaining.
Right, and it'd probably be overall a better picture than the buckets that are moving with the water, you know what I mean, right now.
A little caulking.
Get our gloves out. And
works for me.
Well, we have a motion on the table. I would second that to authorize our county attorney to work with theirs at that cost and see if this then goes to their city council and back to our board and so on.
All right, and the motion is?
The motion is to allow Joshua to negotiate the terms of a dollar payment for the facility. We do all the repairs. The city no longer has to carry insurance. And should we vacate the building, it reverts back to the city of Anthem.
Well, they've got the right of first refusal for a dollar.
Yeah.
Right, well, yeah. We'll they can work see what out. The best legal vehicle is for accomplishing that.
All right, all those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed say no, and the motion carries 5-0. Item 17, Chairman's Report, honoring Siouxland District Health Department Board and employees at the next meeting. Kevin Green sent me, I've asked if there are good news items and things that are happening that we can help highlight. I think our department heads and elected officials have done an outstanding job. Kevin gave me maybe 8 or 9 of them 1 month, and I thought, well, it'd be nice in the spirit of what we did with the Veterans Affairs Commission to have the Siouxland District Department's or Health Department's board and any Siouxland employees in that effort come next week. And so just note that that'll be, we'll ask for a short presentation and honor some of their good news. And I'm not sure what we're doing as far as refreshments, but we will find out, and they'll be forthcoming. Item B is human resources focus at the department head meeting on June 27th. I sat down with Ed a couple of times and looking for updates for the handbook, policy, and procedures, expected procedures regarding TrueSpeak. There's been some discussion on previous forms that were used, whether they're for counseling or discipline and so on, and how that interfaces with TrueSpeak. So just wanted to update the board that we'll be looking to Ed and his department in order to make sure that everyone's on the same page as to procedures and share that back with the board. Any questions on anything there? Item 18 is reports on committee meetings.
Do we need to do this?
This item, Supervisor Monson's asking about the Woodbury County Soil and Water Conservation District 2080 agreement. I asked for this to be pulled from the agenda because Joshua hadn't reviewed it at the time. So it may be fairly standard, but I was looking for a review and wasn't fair to him to ask him to do so in that short of time.
Community Action Agency, the board was apprised of this earlier, but it's incredible what the general relief does. It provides heating and utilities, water utilities, burials. This year to date, 18. That means to be in that number of 18, you have absolutely no other source to get buried, none. Work clothes, that sounds silly, but if a guy gets a job on construction, he has to have steel-toed shoes and probably the uniform that puts him on the job. And if he can't afford to buy that, he can't go to work. Seven this year so far. Medical expenses, rent or mortgage, 143. Transportation, 67 this year. Total people served to date, 440. This is last resort. No other funds are available to get this stuff done. I just find it incredible that we have to do that, but amazing we have a mechanism to get it done. That's all I got.
Very good. Other committee reports.
Well, I attended an in-service with Ed and Melissa last Wednesday, put on by Wellmark in Sioux Falls, called Bold Moves, and feel free to chime in. This is what we should be, Jeremy, look at me. We all need one of these, and every hour that we sit here, we need a stretch. That's what we learned, that for every hour, we either need to get up or we need to demonstrate healthy moving for our employees. So just kind of, you might want to get us all one of these and weave it into your agendas.
Keeping under an hour, right?
Right.
Or keep the meetings and under an hour, which is what I would suggest. But
would you do mine for me, Jackie, so that...
Huh?
Would you do mine for me?
You're stretching?
Yeah.
Actually, the morning was, I thought, pretty informative. The afternoon was a sales job from Wellmark on services they could offer, but I thought you might find this as interesting. They did talk a lot about the difference between climate and culture, and they said the climate of an agency really is the surface things that you do, like vision and mission and rules and regulation, that kind of stuff. But the culture really is what is beneath the surface, and it's kind of the belief systems that people have, and you need to align the two, and oftentimes they're not aligned, and organizations think they're improving the culture when they're really not, because they're not going deep enough. And some of the things that can improve culture are minimal politics, minimal confusion, a high morale, emotional wellness, and a community well-being. And of course, they didn't give us any real specific pathways to get to there. Oh, yes, they did. We could hire them. And they would come in and teach us how to do that. But I just thought going forward, it's just stuff we'll have to keep in mind, that you gotta keep the vision out in front of people and make sure that we're all working towards it, because they do end up, as years go by, you know, ours are fresh because we just did them. So I think right now we're doing pretty well, but as the years go by, they kind of find, and these people change up here, which happens too. We lose sight of it. So it was interesting. The food was really good,
very
healthy.
Actually, it was healthy.
It was.
If you're going to promote being a healthy environment, a healthy employer, I think that's really important.
Yeah. They had two different, I'll just tell you what, in case we ever want to do this, they had two different kinds of yogurt. Someone said it's girl food, but I liked it. Two different kinds of yogurt, and then all these different toppings and Nutri-Grain bars, coffee and orange juice.
What about
No donuts, no.
Dave doesn't want to go. Me either.
So hot dogs didn't fit into that?
Hot dogs didn't fit in. And then in the afternoon, they had separate little bowls, and they had like pretzels and nuts and.
Losing control. We have to listen to him.
According to Mr. Clausen, we're devolving.
So, we would not be devolving if we were doing this every hour on the hour. I'm telling you.
Just wanted to quickly thank everyone who participated in today. Our department heads, elected officials. I thought that was a great thing on everybody's part, including all the supervisors and collectively pitching in. And I thought we put a good foot forward on our day. So.
Mr. Chairman, you skipped ahead. That comes under board comments.
Mr. Anyway, Clausen, I am not my normal self. I'm sorry.
I wanted to congratulate you and David Gleiser, because I think this was an excellent thing you've done, and I'm quick to point out your mistakes, so I think this was something that you can be proud of.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome, sir.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
Are we still on committee reports?
We are mixing and mashing, but
we're
down
to 20 already. Oh, skip down there.
Man,
so,
I blinked.
Do you have a committee report that you'd like to use?
Supervisor Munson and I attended Sioux Rivers today. Last month, we asked where the contract was between Sioux Rivers and Sioux County concerning the two former Woodbury County employees, because we had some discussion at our board level about a contract not existing. I was told a contract was acted upon at the February meeting and the board signed off on it. I investigated that myself, reviewed not only the minutes but the voice recording of the entire meeting to make sure I wasn't missing anything. There is indeed a contract. I was provided that by the secretary, dated February 23rd and signed by the chairman at that meeting. There was no official action taken by the Sioux Rivers Governance Board on the day that it is signed. That was an indisputable fact that the CEO agreed with me on. I sent an email asking for it to be on this month's agenda, fully understanding that Woodbury County would be on the losing end of that vote, because I thought it was best practice to approve a contract that is signed by two parties. Just to use our LED project for an example, I don't think anyone on this board would ever say that because of our very first vote on that topic to move ahead, that all the contracts that we would ever think of and all the vendors we would work with are automatically approved, and Mr. Jeremy Taylor could go sign them outside of this meeting, but that's exactly what happened. And I voiced that concern again today, again asking for it to be on the agenda next month, because I think it sets a terrible precedent to sign contracts without a specific motion by the governing board, especially when the date on the contract is on a meeting date. But unfortunately, I was told we just want to move on. So if our board acted that way, I mean, we even vote to approve agreements when we have an emergency repair because parts of the courthouse are held together by duct tape. Even when we're in that sort of an emergency, we still have a separate motion to authorize the chairman to sign any sort of agreement or undertake any sort of work. So we're just at a complete, I don't know how Woodbury County can claim to be represented at Sioux Rivers when, even when I ask for a motion to be had that I know I'm going to lose, it won't be put on the agenda. Sorry, it wasn't as cheery as everyone else.
That is something that our two representatives to that commission should work out. I don't know how you do it, but that's your job.
I tried asking nicely by email. I tried asking nicely at the meeting. And I'm just informing the board of the response I got.
But you would have voted against it anyway? The contracts, those employees to have
jobs?
Yes.
Any other reports on committee meetings?
If it's one from Matthew, no.
I did have a couple conversations this afternoon from folks south and east of the little courthouse about its importance. So if we were to close that, I think I'd be getting out of town.
There's never been any.
The board's never ever thought of doing that. You can relax.
Well, there was discussion a few years back.
Well, and last but certainly not least, just to let you know, Odo and Smithland and Bronson will be getting back to me sometime in the next, hopefully, 2 or 3 weeks, so we can set a schedule. I did talk to Liz Peterson and Diane McTeer today, and it looks like in July, they're going to look at some dates and let me know for Smithland, but I will, of course, keep all of you informed as to what works in all of our schedules.
Is there any sort of ballpark for June or no?
No, I'm waiting for either Odo or Bronson to bring it before their council, and I've not heard back from either, so I will follow up once again. All right, well, we are now to any citizen concerns. Are there any concerned citizens? Hearing none, are there any concerned board members or their comments?
We already did that.
We already did that, according to Mr. Clausen. And so with that, we want to thank everyone for coming. We are to item 21, which will be a closed session in Iowa Code Section 21.5.1c. And that will be in order to go upstairs and hear from counsel.
Motion to recess.
You need to move in, just move in. Make the motion to go into executive session.
Do I need that here?
Yes.
I second it. Will the auditor please call the roll?
Clausen, Monson, Smith, Taylor.
Aye. We will meet upstairs.